stand together for our call to worship. You can find the call to worship on the screen behind me. I love you, Lord, my strength.
The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer.
My God is my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and strength.
The Lord has redeemed me.
The Lord lives. Praise be to my rock. Exalted be God, my Savior.
Let's sing God's praises.
So let's sing God's praises together. Let's turn to hymn number 454. Open my eyes.
Everybody,
Bible School. See you in a moment, Isaiah.
When you pass through waters, I will be with you. Psalm 43:2.
Isaiah 43:2. It's great job. Great job, Xander. All right, anybody else remember what it was? Phil, what's the verse for BBS this week?
When you pass through the water, I will be with you. Isaiah 43:2.
Bonus. Nice job. What was it, Riley? Great job. That's right. Great job, Riley. I bet so many of you already know what it is. Can you say it all together? Ready? On three. One, two, three.
When you pass through the water, I will be with you. Isaiah 43:2.
Wonderful job. Wonderful job. For our Skid Star Vacation Bible School, we had some different characters that showed up. And one of them was my character, where I played this gentleman. You'd be shocked to hear my name and my character. My name was Brian.
Yay.
Yeah, I know. Really stretching it here. And he played a bit of a goofball who seemed like he didn't fit in anywhere. Real stretch. I know. Either way, and this is my attire. Oh, I forgot something. And of course, I had my life vest on, and nobody else in the whole rafting trip needed to wear the life vest but my character. That tells you something. Either way, what was one of those things I really had trouble with? It seemed like at times people just totally abandoned me. Is that what you were thinking, Xander? Yeah, like for example, for our rafts, as you can see, our whitewater raft right up there. When in my rafting, I described the fact that no one wanted to be in my raft. Even the guys in my own group didn't want to be in my raft. I talked about how Netsky, what happened to Netsky?
He broke.
Actually, he disappeared. I'm going to find him one day. Not only that, but it was so bad that nobody wouldn't be around me. Our original flamingo disappeared for all of EBS. I didn't find him until this morning. So Xander helped make this flamingo right here, or as we called it, a flamingo. Yeah, a flamingo. I know, hilarious. Anyway, here's the flamingo. Xander, that's on you again to hold. That's on Xander. He made it. But we talked about how the skit flamingo decided he wanted to leave me alone. We couldn't keep track of Krabby because Krabby kept on disappearing. Don't look at me like I'm crazy.
Yeah.
I know I found Krabby one night. Can somebody keep an eye on Krabby for me?
Yeah.
Here we go. Just keep on. Oh, I'm so sorry, Caroline. You okay? I'm sorry. I need to say. Yeah, I know it is a real life jacket. Matter of fact, here you go. You keep an eye on this for me if I step on your toe. Your kid wear it? Nope, you don't want to wear it? All right.
I will.
Rafting safety, not her. Go ahead, Riley. Okay. So we talked about that, how all these different things seem to disappear. Nobody wants to spend time with me and whatnot. Because at times it can feel like we have nobody in our life with us. Yet, there's always somebody who will be with us. Yes, Dylan?
What happened to your hat?
What happened to my hat?
Yeah.
I don't remember at all. I don't remember wearing a hat.
One of those hats
because
we're in the water and something
else. See, even the hat wouldn't stick out, would stick around with me. I felt so alone. So much so that the flamingo disappeared, flamingo ran away, Krabby ran away from me, nobody would be in my raft, Netsky disappeared. It was rough. Except the tough part is whenever you feel like you're all by yourself, the truth of it is you're not. Because what's our verse say? When you pass through the
waters, I will be with you.
Yep.
Isaiah
43:2. Oh, I'm sorry. I don't know if they could hear you because Cale back there, he was pointing at his ear. I'm pretending he was. What was that? What's our verse again?
When you pass through the waters, I will be with you.
Waters it might be is you feel like you're all by yourself. You may feel like you're a big old zero. And yet instead, Jesus says, no way, I'm with you. So, when you pass through the waters, when life gets really ugly and really tough, you're really not by yourself. There are adults here who care for you. There are other students who really love you. But especially, so much so, God who promised that when you pass through the waters. Wait, how's that go? I forget.
When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. Isaiah 43:2.
Well done. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much that you love us enough to be with us in the worst of days. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, guys. Here we go. First of all, because guess what? For those of you who are in the first service, it's the same candy. I've got lifesavers here. Go ahead and grab one. They are awesome because ultimately Jesus is our lifesaver. If you'd rather some animals, what are these called? Fruit snacks. One package. Just one package, okay? Because then you make sure everybody has enough, all right? Thanks, Susan. If I have enough, okay? Go ahead, Caroline. Yeah, the lifesavers are there. Fruit snacks are here. Riley, thank you very much. Rachel, let's grab one though. We'll make sure I don't forget. Okay. Go ahead. Get out of here. Feels like your hand. General, what'd you like? You don't want anything? Good idea, Ray. Go ahead and try that. Ready, Dylan? Come over here. Okay. Ready? Set. Here you go. There you go. Just for you. All right. Ourselves together this morning. What would you like to give God thanks for this morning? What would you like to praise God for who God is? What do we need to be praying for? Marianne, what do you got?
We had a good trip out to Chicago and back to Sam, and he's here for 3 weeks. So thanks be to the Lord.
Amen. For the traveling mercies, let alone time to see him, let alone making it here safe, let alone, again, time to see him. Thanks, Marianne. Friends, is there anything else you want to thank God for? Praise God for who God is. Cherry.
We just got
word
that
Romy
Andrews is very close to us. And we're just thankful for that.
Was it Bob? Sure. Just be praying for Bob's family. 52 years of age, he had a massive heart attack. Thanks, Sherry. Mm-hmm. Friends, is there anything else you want to thank God for? Praise God for who God is. Anything we need to be praying for? There are a few praises. One, we have 150 kids who are here from Vacation Bible School. Quite a few are connected with our church, and some who aren't or aren't yet, so thanks be to God. If you look at the Facebook page as well, we had a contest to see whether or not we could raise more than 100 items for Loaves and Fishes. If you look at the tent downstairs near my office in the library area, they trumped that for Loaves and Fishes. The problem with that was is then they were able to splash me continuously with wet sponges. You don't look to be saddened at all by the fact, but let's just say I went home sobbing. Either way, the important thing is that we're able to help more kids and families. Friends, there's something else. Oh, Marianne, yes.
I want to pray for all the churches doing Bible school this summer.
Amen. Because we do have other churches in town here are beginning this week as well, among many others. Thanks, Marianne. Yeah. Vacation Bible School. And on a final note, Tina's mom, my mother-in-law, Carol, who has terminal cancer, she's doing all right at this point. But we do understand, unless God does something incredible, out of the ordinary, and miracle-wise, that these are her last days.
So, pray for a miracle.
Pray for a miracle. Pray for a family. Friends, is there anything else? If not, let's go. Sure, you know, I totally forgot Shirley.
How could you forget me? I'm just thankful to be able to be out to church again.
Glad to have you.
Shirley had a procedure to help strive to begin the healing process for her back. We'll see if it worked, but keep praying for her with whatever's going on there with the healing for her back, let alone the blood clots in her lungs. And you are a walking miracle in many ways, Shirley. All right, friends, let's go to the Lord together in prayer. Thank you. period with how messy this world is. When we look at drug addiction, murders, wars, when we see abuse, when we see children hurting and spouses in a hospital because of the other spouse, when we see how messy life can be, when we can backbite and grumble and argue, when we can hinder you and deal with the sins that plague us, why would you be with us? And yet we thank you that you are a God who is present, that you are not absentee, that you don't go on vacation, that you don't take trips or a day off, that you are the God who is constantly there, that this whole mindset of rest and whatnot is not a part of who you are and your care towards us. We thank you, Father, that you are the God who passes through the waters with us, the raging waters, the terrifying waters, the calm, cool springs, that you are the God who goes through all of that with us. And although the imagery in Isaiah is more about waters that are terrifying, the waters that the Israelites walk through on dry ground after leaving Egypt, yet it still points us to the good days as well. That you are the God who is there in the midst of the terrors of our lives, in the midst of fears for our life, in the midst of the days where it seems as though we will be engulfed by worries, by the cares, by the troubles. You're also the God who walks through the beautiful days with us. Where it's the cool puddle, it's the beautiful stream, it is that area where you're able to trout, fish, or go for a gentle round of canoe, where it is both the beautiful waters as well as the raging rapids. That you are willing to be through all of it with us. Talk about love. For how many people in our lives seem to disappear in the worst of days, you are the God who is there. We pray for us to continue to move and work in our lives and open up our eyes to see how much of a presence you are, how much you desire to walk through the waters with us. Thank you that you go through the worst of days with us. We have been promised an easy ride, but you are the God who walks through the worst of the rides and the best of the rides with us. We've seen your hand at work. We thank you so much for the protection for Sam, let alone for Mary Ann, and it's their meeting in Chicago and their ability to come back here to Mercer. What a gift. We're thanking you, Father, for the different vacation Bible schools throughout this area and around the country. We're praying for your spirit to move and work. Thank you, Father, for your incredible generosity towards us in vacation Bible school. No real injuries of kids. Incredible blessings of food for loaves and fishes, and kids accepting Jesus Christ. We give you thanks, Father, how you move and work. So we come before you, asking for you to walk through the waters with those we lifted up this morning, for Bob's family, in the midst of his surprising death from a heart attack. We ask that you would be with the family and friends, give them comfort and peace as only you can. It's in Jesus' name. We ask, Father, that you be with Shirley in the midst of these days of striving to understand what's going on with her back, the blood clot in her lungs, and whatnot. We pray for healing in Jesus' name. We come before you for many of us struggling with family and issues of health. We're asking that you be with Tina's mom, Carol, and the family in these days as we seem to be waiting for the last breath. So, Jesus' name, we pray. And yet we cling to you because we know that you walk through the waters. And it's not just waters of life here on earth, but that through Jesus Christ, what he has done on the cross for us, about forgiveness of sins and life everlasting, we have hope for life eternal. We get to drink deeply of the wellspring of living water. We thank you that we have that hope through your Son, Jesus Christ. And so, Father, we thank you and praise you. And as we praise, Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, friends, our reading this morning comes from both Isaiah 43, verse 2, as well as Mark chapter 4. Morning, Chuck. Chuck, it looks pretty safe getting up there. Although the flamingos, as you can tell, were moved away.
clear.
Yeah, good. Good, good, good.
Okay, our first verse is Isaiah 43:2. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. Second reading is Mark 4:35 through 41. That day when evening came, he said to his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side." Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along, just as he was in the boat. There were also other boats with them. A furious squall came up, and waves broke over the boat, so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care that we may drown?" He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." And then the wind died down, and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified as they asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him."
Friends, it's the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Let's stand together if you choose to do so. That we have taken from the stained glass windows of the church as we also kick off this summer sermon series on what those windows might mean. We're reminded that images in church, stained glass windows and whatnot, have a true meaning to them. Not just be beautiful, but have a point. This here points us to the fact that in the midst of the waters, you have what are 13 rays, black and gold. They're, no, not Steelers fan, although I may be one. But instead, black and gold, 13 rays, pointing at sunlight, and if it's 13, it means Jesus and probably 12 disciples is the imagery. With the dove there being the Holy Spirit, as well as the cross above, pointing us to Jesus Christ. Then in the midst of being on the waters, who is with those who sail? And yet it also guides us to our vacation Bible school verses. It reminds us that in the midst of the worst of days, that God will be with us. That God doesn't disappear or take a vacation just because times become difficult. That God will be with us. As our kids from Vacation Bible School said many times during the week and many times this morning, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. You guys, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. See, when we're stuck in the raging waters of life, where do we turn? I mean, some people might abandon us. Some people might try to abuse us when the worst of days comes. The story goes like this. There was a real estate agent who had just closed his very first deal. And he came to discover that the property he had just sold was underwater. It was completely flooded. You would think the guy would know this. You would think the customer would have checked, but neither one of them did. One took the other on his word, and the salesman took the word of the person he was selling it for. So much so, worrying pain came upon this real estate agent, though, that he went to his supervisor and asked his supervisor, "I just sold that person land that's unusable. What should I do? Should I call them and apologize? Should I try to sell it back?" And his boss looked at him, and she said, "Are you kidding me? What kind of salesperson are you? Get out there and try to sell them this houseboat." Some people try to abuse your here are terrible situations. That's not how God works. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. Some people will try to abuse our misfortune. That's not how God works at all. At times, God will allow us to go through the terrible times, but it's for us to grow. Growth is rarely comfortable. Growth is rarely easy. You've heard of growing pains with your kids, or maybe you might remember them yourself. When they were growing, the shoes suddenly stopped fitting, and the t-shirts, they didn't seem to last at all. And yet there was also the pain from the growing. Same thing happens for us as Christians. It's not always going to be easy, but in the midst of the worst of days, God will be with you. On a personal note, as I watched Tina's family with this time with Carol and the price that they're paying in the midst of her battling terminal cancer, I'm seeing God do beautiful things in the family and the relationships. But you wish it didn't happen at this time. God's able to use the worst of times at times to bring about beautiful things. With Jesus, as we see in Mark chapter 4, he doesn't disappear when the worst times come. Take note, for example, the storms came and Jesus is in the boat. The scripture tells us that Jesus was without sin. He was tempted in every way, but never sinned. It's not his fault the storms showed up. It doesn't sound like from our passage here that it was the disciples' fault either that the storms of life came. Sometimes we like to point fingers and say, well, this happened to you because you did this, or hidden sin or whatnot. In this case, the storms came, their lives were at risk, and it wasn't the disciples' fault. It wasn't Jesus' fault. It's just that the storms of life came. Just because something bad happens in life doesn't mean that you've done something wrong. Another thing, just because something bad happens doesn't mean that God can't handle it. What happened with the disciples as soon as they went to Jesus? Well, first of all, it sounds like they waited a little bit of time, hoping he'd wake up. It sounds like they were surprised as the boat was almost swamped with the water, so they take their good old sweet time before they finally wake Jesus up and then yell at him. But where did they go when the times were worst? The scriptures don't tell us that they tried to right the boat in themselves after a bit, or try to jump out and swim for shore. They actually went to Jesus. The reminder for us is when the worst of times come, where do you turn? The one who had the power to calm the waves still has the power to calm the storms in our lives. So the disciples went to Jesus, and what was he able to do? Instantly, he calmed the waters. Instantly, he calmed the storms. Everything changed when they were willing to go to him, and Jesus was willing to change the situation. But it doesn't always happen that quickly, does it? There are some storms that we go through in life where it feels like the boat will collapse because it's been in the storm for so long. In Isaiah 43, the Israelites are given this promise by God. Isaiah chapters 1 through 39 are full of God's judgment on the wayward promised children of Israel. Beginning with chapter 40, everything changes as God promises to act on their behalf. Isaiah 43 carries on this promise from God, and yet it takes hundreds of years, finally, for God to move and work on their behalf. Because at times, God doesn't move as quickly as we would like. That doesn't always give us hope, does it? But let's deal with reality. There are some storms in our lives that God will fix like that, and suddenly the waves will come. And then there are some storms in our lives that will take a long time for it to change. Whether it's a quick fix, or if it takes an incredibly long time, where do we turn? There's only one who was able to calm the storms. And there's only one who, when you pass through the waters, will be with you. There's only one. His name is Jesus. But the beautiful thing of this is it's not as though God's distant, that God is up close and personal. As we can see in our video clip this morning, this is how Jesus acts in our life.
Thank you.
Wonder Woman, sorry, that scene,
here we go.
In that scene from Wonder Woman, we have Wonder Woman there willing to dive off the cliff and to save the guy who would become her fiancé, for lack of a better term. And yet, this is a risk. She's actually not supposed to have any kind of close relationship with people from the outside world. But she's willing to break it to break that restraint to save someone's life. That's what Jesus has done for us. He gets personal. That's what's so wonderful about it. One, Jesus becoming a human being, and two, him dying on the cross for us. It is personal. If we're thinking about it in that scene, you can do many ways to try to save someone. For example, you could, of course, pull out my professional-sized boogie board here. Anybody want to use this in the raging waters? I don't even think this is going to work for you with a water gun. And yet, you could, if somebody's drowning. Sorry, Brayden, almost took you out. Yeah, you could try to use that to save. But guess what? It's not going to do much good, especially somebody who's terrified. If you've ever seen someone who is terrified in a situation, imagine in the water. They think it's dangerous to go try to save someone whenever they're in a dangerous place in the waters, because many folks who've been that first responder have died trying to save someone by jumping in. It's a distance thing. You could try to throw, like my life preserver here that I would use in the skit. But if I throw that out there, great. But how does somebody who even uses it get to shore? And the other thing, honestly, is those things can be a little tough to put on. Life preserver when you're not thinking straight. I should say life vest there. If you're not thinking straight, it will not help. So how can you help someone else? If it's a real life-saving situation, try to grab some sort of life preserver, or if you're in the water, take off a shirt or something and toss it to someone, and that way you can drag them to shore. Ken, I know, you don't have to jump on that. We're okay. But that's all you could do. That way it's safe. You are safe on the shore. In a real life-saving situation, this is probably your best bet. That's not what Jesus did. In this regard, the person who is freaking out in the water may not kill you trying to save themselves because they are in a place of extreme terror and high anxiety. What Jesus would do for us is instead, he jumps right in the water. There is no life preserver he throws, it's himself. There is no t-shirt that he gives, it's the cross. There is no cute little rope with the preserver there on the end of it. He is right next to us. That's how personal Jesus gets in how caring for us. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. Now, I'll be hanging out on the shore, because Jesus easily could just stand on the edge of the shore and go like that, and you could float out of the water. If he has that kind of power, then you believe in the resurrection from the dead. That's not how God works. Steve, I'm going to get a little close. He gets right next to us. Was that uncomfortable? No? You're okay with it? Great. No, I'm just joking, Steve. And yet, most of us here in church, if I do this sort of thing, we get a little squirmy. What's that preacher going to do? Did he catch me napping? What's that guy going to do? Where's he going to go? Seriously, I love the looks on some of your faces. Like, leave me alone, preacher. Don't call on me. And yet, that's how we can get the feeling. Right, Caroline?
Yeah, we can.
Like, what's that strange man doing? It can't be uncomfortable. Jesus gets involved. He desires to be personal with us. He is in the boat with the disciples, not distant on a shore or like some sort of distance learning that you can get from Grand, what is that? Grand Valley University?
Grand Canyon.
Thank you. I was almost in the ballpark. You know, just like you have this idea, like it's distance learning. You can take courses, or when I was in seminary, take them online or whatnot. No, this is up close and personal, one-on-one. Incredible thing with Jesus. He didn't have to do things this way. But instead, he was in life with the disciples. He touched people. He healed. He ate meals with folks, including when he came back from the dead. It was personal, not long distance learning. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. It's not the nice card you get in the mail with somebody saying, I care for you. It's when they show up. Many of you and folks from Tina's churches have done an incredible thing in the midst of these days. Meals have been dropped off. But blueberries that were picked and dropped off on the back porch. Those of you offering in many different ways to help. have done incredible things for us. Flowers that have shown up. You have been an incredible gift for us. Well, I love it. That one's smiling the whole time. That's awesome. Hey, I'm almost done. But when I was her age, my goodness, that preacher would just drag on and on and on. So quite simply, if you haven't gotten the point, it's personal. The story goes that there's this cruise ship going along in the water, and they look over, and the folks on the cruise ships can see this gentleman on a small island, raggedy clothes, looks like a really long beard, looking a little rough around the edges, screaming and yelling, dancing. They could have sworn they heard the word help. Well, one person on the cruise ship went over to the captain and said, "Captain, what's wrong with that man? Is there anything amiss? Should we help him?" And the captain says, "Well, I don't know what's wrong with him. Every time we go by, he does the same thing." I guess at times we get to thinking like Jesus is like that. Like, he's just out there and I'll keep yelling and hopefully he'll make an appearance. He desires instead to be personal. But if he's not part of your life, then he is that dude. It's as though you're on the island by yourself and he's just passing by. He desires to be part of your life. He desires to be part of your life. Because with him, he came that it might be personal. He's on the boat, and the water and the storms changed when he became involved. "When you pass through the waters, I will be with you." In Isaiah 43, it seems like, I think I already mentioned this, that the waters they're speaking of might be with the parting of the Red Sea with the Israelites crossing through. Maybe it's Joshua entering the Promised Land as they go through the Jordan River. Whatever it is, the imagery is that whenever you go through the worst of days, the most terrifying experiences, that God will be with you. It's a beautiful thing to have a lifeguard at the beach or at the pool. But I haven't made many friends that are lifeguards. Jesus doesn't desire just to be the lifeguard hanging out on there. He desires to walk through life with us. If you ask Elisha, our office administrator, about tech support, well, she has some words that maybe they can't repeat in church here, because our tech support has been very frustrating at the church, especially with the program that Kale has run admirably this morning. Tech support, when I've called, that's normally a frustrating, "Please hold, your call is very important to us." And then you wait 45 minutes. So important, you have to waste my day. That's not how Jesus works. It's not tech support. But friends, in our times, from our viewpoint, sometimes it looks like tech support. Sometimes it looks like we're calling customer service because we're waiting. What did the disciples learn? The longer the waves crashed. What did the disciples learn the longer they had to wait? The more it sinks in, maybe they just learn just how powerful Jesus is. Sometimes we have to sit there and wait. We're learning more about who God is. The beautiful thing is us knowing Jesus in a more and more of a powerful way in our lives is an incredible gift. So think about the worst of days you've had. Where have you seen God? In the days where you could have said that the waters were about to cave in on you, where did you see God at work? How did God, when you passed through the waters, how was God with you? Well, here's your assignment for this week if you choose to accept it. Tell someone about the time or times that God was with you in the midst of the raging waters. Tell someone. Think about it and tell someone about that time. It's really beautiful if it's somebody who doesn't go to church here. That's your assignment if you choose to accept it. Because when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. The picture on the screen points us to the fact about how God is involved in our lives. The cross on the top of the mast with the Holy Spirit coming down in the midst of the sail, with the Holy Spirit on the sail and pushing of the air, as is another word, or wind, which is another word for spirit in the New Testament. And you have the 13 rays coming down. And even the symbol for Jesus there with the Greek lettering rho, which is the P, and the X or chi. So first two letters in Jesus' name, chi and rho, getting at the initials for Jesus. Why do we say all of that? It points us to the fact that in the midst of the waters, when God will be with us. In the midst of the worst of days, God promises, I will be with you. Or as our kids at Vacation Bible School can say, almost without even looking at the board, they can say, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. Amen. Well, friends, I would encourage you to pray with me if you would. We can pray. I encourage you to repeat after me. The prayer will be on the screen behind me, but it's better for us to close our eyes, turn up our hands toward heaven, and just talk with God. So let's pray. Lord God, loving Father,
Lord God, loving Father,
I love you.
I love you.
Thank you that you are with me.
Thank you that you are with me.
Thank you for saving me.
Thank you for saving me.
Strengthen me to enter the raging waters.
Strengthen me to enter the raging waters.
Empower me to live for you.
Empower me to live for you.
I love you.
I love you.
I pray in Jesus' name.
I pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Friends, let's continue to worship for the giving of our tithes and our offerings.
Thank you.
Peace. Amen. Amen.